Good morning, brothers and sisters of Tweedsmuir Memorial Presbyterian Church. Welcome to today's Sunday worship for March 21st, year 2021. There is a few announcements. First is we still have our Wednesday Lenten services every Wednesday. And this upcoming Wednesday on March 24th, it's held by the Westminster United Church in Orangeville. Please join and worship with us by watching the Lenten services on Tweedsmuir Presbyterian's channel. You can find it in our channel by just searching Tweedsmuir Presbyterian and click onto the folder for Lent 2021. Or you can just look at the videos and it should be the latest one that is available. We are able to worship together for the 24th, and that would be it's viewable on March 24th. So join together to watch. And there is a Tweedsmuir virtual coffee hour every Tuesday to Friday at 10. So if you'd like to share anything, just join us for chat. May the peace of the Lord Jesus Christ be with you all. The call to worship. Come, all who desire to know God. Come, all who yearn to see Jesus. Come, all who thirst for the Spirit. God is in our midst this day. So let us praise God's holy name. We will worship God with heart, mind, strength, and soul, and declare God's goodness to us. Let us sing our opening hymn. That will be hymn number 445, Open Our Eyes, Lord. Let us pray the opening prayers of adoration and confession together. Let us pray. Creating God, loving Son, guiding Spirit, with springtime sun and the promise of new life, you wake us from our slumbers. We glorify your name, for you are faithful to us. Through every season of the year and every season of life, we are grateful for your patience and persistence. Draw near to us, even through the times we cannot draw near each other. Your promise of hope in Jesus Christ, drawing life out of grip of death, means so much to us. Even as his cross looms on us on the horizon in this season of Lent, we praise you for Jesus' courage and compassion, which bring renewal to us in the midst of our challenges. We praise you, O God, for the love that never lets us go. Jesus, our friend and Savior, we ponder your sacrifice. We recognize the self-centered ways in which we lead our lives. You entrust us with the task of sharing your love in this world. Yet we fall short. We get lost in our own plans and worries and neglect to show love, even to those right beside us. We find some people too difficult to care for. We think some people unworthy of your love and ours. Our own needs seem insurmountable, and we cannot reach out to someone else. Forgive us, Lord Jesus. Renew a light spirit within us, so that we find the courage to go on and the compassion to reach out in your name. We ask these things in the name of the risen Lord, who taught us to pray the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. The assurance of pardon. Jesus said, "Come to me, all you who labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest." Friends, trust that peace and forgiveness are God's gifts to you this day. Be renewed by the power of the Spirit that moves with you into each new day. Amen. Let us pray together in the prayer of understanding. Loving God, by the power of your Spirit, open our hearts to receive and understand your word. Speaking through the scriptures, teach us your wisdom and reveal your truth for our lives and our times. Through Jesus Christ, the living word. Amen. It is now children's story time. Today's children's story is taken from the Gospel of John, chapter 12, verse 28 to 33. For the Bible says, "Father, glorify your name." Then a voice came down from heaven. "I have glorified it and will glorify it again." The crowd that was there and heard it said it had thundered. Others said an angel had spoken to him. Jesus said, "This voice was for your benefit, not mine. Now is the time for judgment on this world. Now the prince of this world will be driven out. And I, when I am lifted up from the earth, will draw all people to myself." He said this to show the kind of death he was going to die. May the Lord bless the hearers of his words. Jesus draws people to himself. We all know that we have magnets at home, and magnets attract many different things. And we have a few objects here. First, let's try out this magnet on this glass jar. Oh, nothing. Doesn't do anything, right? How about let's take a magnet close to, say, a steel spoon, a metal spoon. Doesn't really work. How about let's take this magnet close to paper clips? You see these paper clips got easily attracted and stuck to the magnet. The magnet has great power and will draw many objects to itself. It reminds me of something that Jesus taught about himself. The people who were following Jesus thought Jesus had come to set up an earthly kingdom. But Jesus came to earth to die for our sins, so that we could join him in his heavenly kingdom. Even so, because Jesus knew he would soon be crucified, he said to his followers, "I am very troubled. What should I do? Should I pray to the Father and ask him to save me?" How do you think you'd answer him? Jesus told the people, "No. This is the very reason that I came. And when I am lifted up, I will draw everyone to myself." The Bible tells us that he told them that so they would know how he was going to die. The drawing power of this magnet is very strong. But it's nothing compared to the drawing power of Jesus. When we see his great love, we're drawn to him. He willingly died on the cross to pave the price for our sin. And when we trust in him, we receive the right to become the children of God. Even after we become God's children, we will still sin. And that's not pleasing to him. But that doesn't mean he will stop loving us. He has the power to draw us back to himself. There is no power stronger than the love of Jesus. Let us pray together. Dear God, we thank you that Jesus was willing to be lifted up on the cross, so we can have eternal life. In Jesus' name, Amen. Let us listen and hear God's words together. Today's responsive reading is from Psalm chapter 51, verse 1 to 12. For the director of music, a psalm of David. When the prophet Nathan came to see him after David had committed adultery with Bathsheba. Verse 1. Have mercy on me, O God, according to your unfailing love. According to your great compassion, blot out my transgressions. Wash away all my iniquity, and cleanse me from my sin. For I know my transgressions, and my sin is always before me. Against you, you only, have I sinned, and done what is evil in your sight. So you are right in your verdict, and justified when you judge. Surely, when I was sinful at birth, sinful from the time my mother conceived me, yet you desired faithfulness even in the womb. You have taught me wisdom in that secret place. Cleanse me with hyssop, and I will be clean. Wash me, and I will be whiter than snow. Let me hear joy and gladness. Let the bones you have crushed rejoice. Hide your face from my sins and blot out all my iniquity. Create in me a pure heart, O God, and renew a steadfast spirit within me. Do not cast me from your presence or take your Holy Spirit from me. Restore to me the joy of your salvation and grant me a willing spirit to sustain me.
The New Testament lesson is Hebrews 5:5-10. Neither did Christ presume to set himself up as high priest, but was set apart by the one who said to him, "You're my son. Today I celebrate you." In another place, God declares, "You are a priest forever in the royal house of Melchizedek." While he lived on earth, anticipating death, Jesus cried out in pain and wept in sorrow as he offered up priestly prayers to God. Because he honored God, God answered him. Though he was God's son, he learned trusting obedience by what he suffered, just as we do. Then, having arrived at the full stature of his maturity, and having been announced by God as high priest in the order of Melchizedek, he became the source of eternal salvation to all who believed in him.
The gospel lesson is taken from John 12, verses 20 to 33. A grain of wheat must die. There were some Greeks in town who had come up to worship at the feast. They approached Philip, who was from Bethsaida in Galilee. "Sir, we want to see Jesus. Can you help us?" Philip went and told Andrew, and Andrew and Philip together told Jesus. Jesus answered, "Time's up. The time has come for the Son of Man to be glorified. Listen carefully. Unless a grain of wheat is buried in the ground, dead to the world, it is never any more than a grain of wheat. But if it is buried, it sprouts and reproduces itself many times over. In the same way, anyone who holds on to life just as it is, destroys that life. But if you let it go, reckless in your love, you'll have it forever, real and eternal. If any of you wants to serve me, then follow me. Then you'll be where I am, ready to serve at a moment's notice. The Father will honor and reward anyone who serves me. Right now, I am storm-tossed, and what am I going to say? Father, get me out of this. No, this is why I came in the first place. I'll say, Father, put your glory on display." A voice came out of the sky. "I have glorified it, and I'll glorify it again." The listening crowd said, "Thunder." Others said, "An angel spoke to him." Jesus said, "The voice didn't come for me, but for you. At this moment, the world is in crisis. Now Satan, the ruler of this world, will be thrown out, and I, as I am lifted up from the earth, will attract everyone to me and gather them around me." He put it this way to show how he was going to be put to death. Your scriptures for today.
It is now quiet reflection time. Let us listen to the anthem together.
I'm on your side. Ooh. when you're on the streets, when evening falls so hard, I will comfort you. I'll take your part. Oh, when darkness comes and pain is all around, like a bridge over troubled water, I will lay me down, like a bridge over troubled water, I will lay me down. Sail on, silver girl, sail on by, your time has come to shine, all your dreams are on their way, see how they shine, oh.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Today's gospel story is another reaffirmation of Jesus' conviction. We see that once again, people have come forward to Jesus, and yet Jesus confirms again about what is yet to come. We know that by this time, like always, Jesus have the option of not going through with it, but chose to commit. This reminds me of a joke. There once was a grossly overweight man who was bullied by his work colleagues into going on a diet. For 3 weeks, he resisted temptation, even changing his route to work to avoid his favorite bakery. Then one day, to the horror of his workmates, he turned up at the office clutching a huge chocolate cake. When his colleagues berated him, he was quick to offer an explanation. "I accidentally drove by the bakery this morning, and there were loads of tasty treats in the window. I felt this was fate. So I prayed to God saying, 'If you want me to have one of those delicious chocolate cakes, show me a sign. Let there be parking space directly in front of the bakery.' And sure enough, the 8th time around the block, there it was." From this joke, we know that if we do not commit, or on the reverse side, or have already decided, no matter which action or other action no matter what kind of action, would stray away from it, isn't it? Today's gospel can be seen as pretty grim. The crowd came, and yet Jesus still predicted his death. In John's gospel, this event came after Jesus entered Jerusalem on a donkey. What is important here is the symbolism by John. The Greeks, as described by John, are people called God-fearers, non-Jewish people who admire the Jewish faith and respected its traditions. They also believed in God. And these God-fearers represent the scattered children of God, the other sheep, that Jesus, that God kept on saying, whom God went after, like in the Good Shepherd. And the arrival of these God-fearers triggered what is called the hour, the time that Jesus will go on the cross and then resurrect. These, what we call the Greeks, signal the closing of a chapter for Jesus. His ministry in Judaism is finished, and he is now belongs to the wider world. His ministry starts now, extends, is expanded to the wider world. And we reflect this in our faith statement, the Apostles' Creed. Now, where we say that God, the Church, is universal, is Catholic, that which means universal in Greek. And of course, during this gospel story, Jesus, instead of confronting them, continues to explain. Right? Instead of confronting them in arguments and parables and such, just continues to explain. Jesus' sacrifice brings about life for others. But his disciples must practice this discipline so that they could procure life for themselves. The crowd clearly hears what Jesus intended to do. Jesus widened the circle of his flock, and this was also a hurdle for the earliest Christians. This concludes that God was also at work among all peoples, and this affirms a new direction in the ministry of Jesus without rejecting Israel. John suggests that this commitment, this widening of ministry, signals the start of the hour. To embrace the Greeks means that Jesus is now headed on the path that will lead to death for the world. And when we think more about this, this is a natural culmination of Jesus' ministry, isn't it? We get to see what the other sheep were when Jesus did his ministry among the Jews. We get to know that these other sheep were the oppressed, the poor, the sick, the widows, etc., etc. Basically, outcasts of society. Especially in this mentality of us versus them. Like, who are you? Who are with the in crowd, right? We see that these others were considered them. They're not the in crowd. They're not us. But Jesus reminded everyone of God's instructions, and God's instructions has been since the beginning of time. It is not them or you, or them versus us, or us versus them. It is only just us. Right? We are all God's children. And now, to go further in this, it is a natural culmination that the other sheep of God are also the non-Jewish people of the world. And we can see that even in this world today, it is not an easy thing to go over it, this us versus them mentality. If the Pharisees and the Sadducees struggled with this thinking, and even the earliest Christians in Jerusalem struggled with the arrival of Gentiles, if this happened to these groups of people, imagine the stir when Jesus suddenly, in Jerusalem, that was right after he came in riding on a donkey, met with this non-Jewish crowd in the Jewish temple. Must be quite a revelation, isn't it? This sums up John's statement in chapter 3, verse 16. God so loved the world, doesn't it? With open heart and God's help, this could be overcome. The Apostle Peter had said, had this change of heart in his experience in Joppa. Peter, eventually, after his experiences in Joppa, in his dreams, he argued that Cornelius is indeed a child of God. The apostle, the Rabbi Paul, announced that he is an apostle to the Gentiles. This must have been quite a shock to people who knew him, right? Who knew the old him. The theologian Gary Burge said, "If we do not understand the radical mandate of Jesus or his willingness to take the social risk of being with Greeks in the Jerusalem temple, we do not comprehend Jesus' extreme love for the world. At the same time, we have to understand the risk. After hearing about the Greeks, Jesus immediately speaks of sacrifice and the cross." During Easter, during this time of Easter, we come to experience again that when God said it is time, it does not mean a schedule had to be made or had to be met or that we are late. It does not mean that time is slipping away and have to make up for it. It means it reaffirms God's love for us. The time of Easter, time of Lent, reaffirms us of God's commitment and persistence, and reaffirms us of God's decision and views us all as valuable. And during Lent, let us recommit to God and to Jesus. And as we commit to what Jesus intended us to be, to be God's light in the world to everyone, to share God's love in every corner of the earth. Let us pray together. Let us pray together in the ending prayers of thanksgiving and intercession. Let us pray for each other. Steadfast God, in the midst of unending change and challenge, we give you thanks for your presence to sustain us. When we find it too hard to understand why things happen, we are grateful that you are with us. We understand our fears. You support and guide us. And you give us courage to face the unknown. We give you thanks that you intend goodness for us, that your gift of faith is a solid rock which supports us, and that prayers gives us the hope you keep working in ways seen and unseen for goodness to prevail. Loving God, in this time of uncertainty, when there is much to be anxious about, we pray for the world you love. Send in your healing spirit to guide countries and communities as they respond to COVID-19. Bless the work of medical researchers and frontline healthcare workers in these stressful times. Bless the plans to offer vaccine to all who want it, and give us patience and common sense as we wait our turn for vaccination. Send your healing spirit to bring peace with justice to the troubled places in our world. Bring care and comfort to those who have been hurt in conflict, wisdom to those who offer leadership in their communities, and courage to those who advocate for the most vulnerable. Send your healing spirit to mend relationships who find themselves in tension or turmoil. We pray for mutual respect to grow between peoples who look at each other with suspicion, and among people who have experienced painful histories with each other. Open our hearts and minds to those whose situations and concerns we don't understand, and bring your gift of reconciliation to us all. Send your healing spirit to people we know and the earth you love. We remember before you friends in grief, relationships marked by tension, those facing difficulty at work or finding work, disagreements in our church or community, concerns about the environment we depend on. We pray for the continuing ministry of the church in our neighborhood and around the world. As we prepare to celebrate Easter and Christ's resurrection, help us to plan safely and creatively. God, we also pray for our friends, family, and people within our community, such as our brother Howard Cunnington, our brother Adam, and Ron's friend Eric Penny's family, for Eric Penny recently passed away. And we pray for others and for concerns we bear in our hearts this day, whom we have not spoken out loud. Shine the light of your comfort into their lives. Send your healing spirit to raise our hearts and our hopes with the promise of new life in Christ. Restore to us the joy of your salvation and sustain in us all our willing spirit. Receive our prayers in the name of your risen Lord, of our risen Lord, Jesus Christ, your Son. Amen. Let us sing our ending hymn. Our ending hymn is hymn number 772, Christ for the World We Sing.
To heal.
Let us now go and delight in doing God's work, leaving our fingerprints in places where God would want them to be. And now may our Creator direct your ways so that you may always walk upon His road. And may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you this day and every day. Amen.
May God's blessings surround you each day as you trust Him and walk in